Welcome to this webinar. Basically, it's Industry 4 and Smart Manufacturing. This is sponsored by IPQC Consulting company. We provide services to SMEs, small and medium enterprises. Part of our knowledge sharing sessions, we invite industry experts frequently. And we invite this time expert, IoT expert and manufacturing expert, Mr. Deepak Naik, to this event. And before I introduce his background, I just invite Mr. Pradeep as a panel member to this webinar. So, this event is basically a webinar. We'll be having a more of a discussion. Directly we can handle the questions. Members will be discussing directly. And basically this Blue Chink company is Deepak is representing is a founder and CEO of Blue Chink. Is a pioneer in many IoT related innovations. He's expert, IoT expert, he's industry expert. He's bringing his a lot of technology and innovations to this webinar. And also we invite other panel member, Mr. Pradeep Salve. He's also IoT expert. He's also pioneer in basically in business analytics. So I request Mr. Deepak to, basically introduce more about his company's achievements while introducing about it. Please go ahead.
Okay.
Deepak, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, Raju. So
please go ahead, Deepak. You take over.
Oh, okay. Yeah, thank you.
You can share your slides. It is already you are a co-host now, so you can share the slides.
Okay, sure. So
there is some issue here. Some issue. So you can go ahead. No problem. No issues.
Okay, Raju, thank you so much. Thank you, IPQC Consulting. Before I start, is my audio and video clear?
Yeah. Audio is clear. Video also clear. You can go ahead and share your.
Okay. So for all the women members in this contact in this webinar, a happy Women's Day, and also a happy Women's Day to all the people because of which we are all present here.
Yeah.
Right. Thank you very much for spending and taking out your time and making this as a priority the next 1 hour, and your connect to this webinar is an indication that you want to know more, you want to see how best you can apply this to your existing knowledge base, either increase of business, either adopting it in your business, because I see that we have different sets of people here, manufacturers, people who are system integrators, and people who are domain specific knowledge, right? So let me start with this, and so some guidelines. So when I'm on any slide, and if there are any questions, Raju or even anybody, they can unmute and they can ask question, and we want to make it as a very interactive rather than a one-way communication. So the purpose of this webinar is to share what we have.
Yeah.
And what you have to receive can only be possible if you have questions.
Yeah.
If you have doubts. Right. And so I encourage everyone to ask questions. Stop me anytime.
Yeah.
We will discuss on that, come to a conclusion, and then move to the new slide. All right. So our allocated time is 1 hour 15 minutes or so. It all depends on everybody's interest, everybody's hunger to know more. Okay, so let me begin with this, Raju, with this note.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Can you see my screen?
Yeah, we can go ahead.
Okay. So, very brief on the history of about manufacturing, what was happening and what is happening right now, right? In 1800, you know, we started manufacturing industry, started with using water power. Water power can also be steam. Because when you use it, it be, hello?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah. So it's all based on water. And then in 1900, we started having more assembly lines. Electricity became a major thing, in the mass production assembly lines. And in 2000, 20 years back, there was more of computer and automation which started. Now today, what everybody calls it as a fourth industrial revolution, right, is basically on cyber physical systems.
Yes.
All right. And what all these system consists of? You know, those are the things which are there here in the slides, as you can see. New one on AI, 3D printing. Robotics, data analytics, and driving efficiency, increasing the OEE, right? Using actuators and sensors, and using connectivity technologies across all the supply chain, just not about manufacturing. It can be related to warehouse management, it can related to web application. So all the points in the industrial world are connected, right? Mm-hmm. And that is how you will have unprecedented levels of data and huge increase of compute power is the need of the day. So if you have any questions or anything you want to know more about this slide, Raju and all the people, you are free to ask.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So what we have seen is that people call this also as a new electricity for manufacturing, that is AI. So AI is a new electricity, and in fact they say that experts are of the opinion that if industries don't adopt to AI, you know, they are forced to shut down their operations because one is that the competitors will use the latest technologies to increase their operational efficiencies, productivity, control costs. And as a manufacturer, if you don't adopt, then you will be in a very difficult position to maintain and compete with industries who are leveraging technology. All right. So this is the opinion, but I see that things are happening in this particular fashion. If you have seen as a case study, industries who are not using computers still now are no longer in the business. Right. So, and every industrial revolution has taken almost 100 years, one each revolution. And when you look at it, we have just started. And if you are or if you are an astrologer or if you are who can know more of intuition, know that what is the basis of all this now, and that is what is technology, right? And people have just started executing and implementing smart factories, and we already have a couple of cases where we have done and made a smart factory. There are a few challenges for any of these manufacturing industries. You know, one is the technology adoption. this I feel is one of the biggest challenge for many of them, because the industry domain expertise are basically in manufacturing, in their processes, in their production planning, in the overall flow of a manufacturing process. But how do we take advantage of a technology and adopt? Which technology to use? Or what to use and what not to use?
Yeah.
Industries have spent a lot of money, and sometimes they conclude wrongly that, no, this technology is not meant for us. Because they were doing more of an experimentation with the technology and R&D with the technology at the cost of their own peril and their own risk, right? So what is the technology know-how and a dedicated focus and plan from the leadership team is a must for any industry to adopt technology, right? And then second problem or a challenge what they have is basically on process innovation. This I feel is the biggest hurdle because this is related to mindset. And I know that there are a few people here in this webinar now who are experts in their domain and who know that what should be the process, and it has been happening for years together, generations together. And now we are talking and saying that, okay, why don't you use technology and make technology as your main weapon or a tool to improve process, becomes a very difficult thing to digest.
Yeah.
Right? But yeah. The advantages of going with a process innovation or using technology far outweighs the disadvantage of, you know, whether it is cost or whether it is operations or whether it is time and energy saving. But still, you know, we have a lot of companies who are still struggling to adapt to this mindset. And then comes the compliance and data management, right? This is also one of the biggest problem, because we have been maintaining everything on paper so far, whether it is our quality process, whether it is our visitor process, or whether it is our attendance, or whether it is our canteen tokens. Anything in the manufacturing is more or less on a paper.
Yeah.
Now, leveraging automation and making sure that you are responsible for an audit and giving the right data and availability of this information any point of time to anybody will be the biggest advantage.
Yes, correct.
All right. And then next is the fourth is the security. This is also one of the biggest vulnerability for a manufacturing industry, because we were never used to IT. And there were, I have seen manufacturing companies where IT was, you know, it was in the storeroom. I will not name that company. In fact, it is such a big company that we use their products every day at home. And I was surprised to see one of our IBM servers that time in this files and all, where they keep the storehouse. And we were not able to see the server because everything was covered in files. And the beauty of that IBM system was that it was running for 15, 20 years. No shutdown, nothing happened. And their whole application of running that was actually in that server. So it is happening, because it's just about that, you know, we don't want to treat IT as a business tool. But now you cannot afford to ignore this, right? It's just not about IT now, it is more about IoT, it is more about IIoT, that is industrial IoT, it is more about operational technology, it is also about AI. AI comes as a broad spectrum and it includes everything, whether it is your data science and analytics, business analytics, includes your machine learning and deep learning. It also includes your automation processes. So AI is a very big and a large term. And the discussion today will be more on how the AI and IoT technologies will help you. And who are the people who have already adopted? And what is the benefit out of this? So any doubts from anybody? Raju, you have any clarifications on this?
Please go ahead. Because it's like you are trying to connect earlier stages, how evolved manufacturing, to technology trends nowadays. Now, please go ahead.
Right. So this is a trend which is happening. And if you look at this, this is a very, very interesting slide. It is not just a slide because it is this research has been done by McKinsey on digital manufacturing globally. And when you look at this, and I suggest that everybody have a look at this and, give me your input. What do you understand by this chart? This actually represent country-wise priority they have given to digital manufacturing. So anybody who can break the ice, who can be a leader so that others will follow and make this a very interactive webinar.
Yesterday, Ola announced that they are setting up 1 million electric scooters manufacturing facility near Bangalore towards Krishnagiri, Osur side. So their manufacturing setup is basically they are going to make every 2 seconds one electric scooter. So to make such a speed, you need to have the system, like you need to have the basic, sophisticated manufacturing system. Industry 4 definitely is going to help them to achieve that speed. So they are bringing the entire thing, automation, Industry 4 concepts from the beginning. It's a massive project and taken up in a global scale. And it's very near to Bangalore. So I can see the trend now. So a huge volume and flexibility and speed, all these three things are integrated in the factory. So it is all, we can see that practically applicable. These are the concepts actually applicable in the factories now.
Oh, very nice. Yeah, very nice, Rajesh. Thanks for the input. So anybody who can comment on this particular slide and what do you observe? What do you think is a takeaway? So Raju, even you can comment. I think you have been interacting with me. I want others also to...
Yeah. Please, if anybody wants to speak, please let me know. I can allow you to speak.
Yeah, I think you can unmute. I think many of them, maybe you can unmute. Yeah, and you can raise
unmute.
Hand.
I'll unmute.
Manoj has raised a hand.
Yeah, I will unmute Manoj. Yeah. Just 1 minute, I'll give me 1 minute. Yeah, you can speak, Manoj. Manoj, are you there? You can speak now. Manoj, you can speak, or I'll read out your question if you already typed the question.
Yeah, Manoj is on mute. I think you have to unmute him.
Unmute. He can unmute.
Yes. Are you listening to me? Are you getting my voice?
Yeah. Please go ahead and ask question.
No. I just want to support that this slide. Basically, we at dairy industry also are doing this type of digital manufacturing. Okay. The moment the milk is poured by the farmer, he gets the message. And amount is transferred every 10th day or 11th day. That is the digital trend which we are following at our dairy industry.
Yeah, it's a digital diary. You know, probably you can say a digital diary. You
Yeah.
can even integrate, you know, this blockchain in the diary form. There is a lot of things can be done because of freshness. You need to be like, you need to adopt digital thing much faster than any other industry.
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Manoj Arora. So the interest, so as you see here, you know, and this is a proof of the proof of the pudding is in the eating is what they say, right? And when you look at it, India, the percentage is 94%. And look at other countries, whether it is China or even US, they are still far behind from a priority perspective. Whether we have implemented or are we implementing, that is the next question. But making digital manufacturing a priority is itself a first step in moving towards it. And in that way, we are in a better position.
Is it because of our strength in IT?
Oh, yeah, one is strength and the people and the resources. See, all the technology is
being the resources.
Right. And when you have, suppose if there is a digital factory, which we have to do, or a process automation, it is easy for Manoj to find out people here in Bangalore and in India, right? Then going out somewhere else, right? If it is hardware, definitely you look at whether China is cheap or Taiwan is cheap. But when you look at services, when you look at software development, because we have so many resources available.
Yeah, India is uniquely positioned, especially Bangalore. There are at least some more than 20 MNCs, research centers are located in Bangalore. And 25 lakhs IT professionals available in Bangalore city. So it's a unique combination. No other city can bring this type of unique combination, manufacturing capabilities and IT capabilities. And a huge market like India. All three combinations you can get in Bangalore. So that's an advantage for India.
Yeah, I agree with you, Raju. I agree with you.
Please go ahead. Yeah, go ahead, Deepak.
So it was hanging. So now, yeah, can you see the next screen? Okay. So what is the digital factory impact? And I think Manoj can also validate on this point that you will definitely have a productivity increase, you know, based on the domain or which factory is that, from 10 to 200% is the data, you know, shared by multiple research companies, right? It will increase your OEE from 3 to 50%. 15% is a base. You know, though the average was saying 3 to 50%, but 1-5%, any process, manual process, if you do digitalization, you are bound to have a 15%. A OEE can contribute either as your availability, as your quality, and as your productivity. So if you multiply all this and what you get is a OEE, so there can be a definite increase of 15%, which everybody has seen, right? Quality cost reduction. This is also a huge. And this, the problem is that since we have very low labor, sometimes it becomes more viable to have a people looking at quality than a software-driven system. However, the errors, what you get, zero defect, is what you can aim leveraging technology, right? Then production cost reduction, 5 to 40%. And other benefits what you can have, you know, from an energy efficiency, lead time reduction, time to market reduction, changeover shortening. If you want to change from one to the other and how, you know, how much shortage of time you can do it, that percentage. So there has been justified, tested and tried data available with us that the fourth industrial revolution will impact directly on all our critical parameters in the manufacturing industry. Right. So any questions here? Okay. Let me go to the next slide. So, okay, I mean, we all understand that, okay, this is good. It will impact our bottom line. It will help increase many things, right? What are the key things required here, right? So as an AI project management or as a digitalization transformation, what we do, you need to have a process and automation engineers. You need to have data scientists. You need to have IT and data engineers. And then you need to have AI creation experts. Now, this is where companies who are in technology or anybody who has this knowledge in a holistic way, who understands AI, who understands software, who understands IT as a thing, plus security, and also to know about this domain knowledge, because domain knowledge is your expertise, not our expertise. But we bring all this, and this is what a manufacturing company should aim at. You know, putting these things, all these four things together to make a AI infrastructure. Okay. So this is a very interesting and a busy slide. So when you have different levels of produce manufacturing, the control and the, you know, the monitoring and control, what we call 0, 1, and 2. And that is where how IT can bring your VLANs. VLANs is your virtual LAN, and, you know, keep assembly separate, warehouse separate, packaging separate, shipping separate, and then bring them onto a management level 4, where you take all these data and put, you know, infrastructure in place and provide a processing. You use different technologies. You use the data, you know, what we call as a data lakes. You use different technologies on MapReduce to arrive at some beautiful insights. And this is where all your levels and all your management things can be taken care of from a single consolidated infrastructure. So anybody wants to have any comments or clarifications on this slide? Okay.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, and if anybody is there, you can raise your hand so that Raju can unmute. So this is how typically...
If anybody wants to ask a question, please ask.
Yeah, so this is actually how a machine learns. You know? You will take a raw data. You extract the relevant features, what is required. For example, in a dairy industry, if my critical parameters are 2 or 3 out of all my 10, 15 parameters, you will take that and take those qualities along with that particular one and do a feature extraction. And then you train the model. And once you have so much of data and memory in that, it will learn. And then you can put out labels. Labels means you will actually give out your final product, saying that, okay, now this is what is the analysis. Right? And there are different ways of how machine learns. You know, machine can learn through supervised learning. This is more technical now, but I'll not get into more detail. But what I'm saying is that this is an area where you need to have a guide, where you need to have an advisor to know what is right and what is wrong, right? These are some of the tools which are required, to build this Industry 4.0, the Python or the SAS, the R language, MATLAB, or different types of data, you know, databases, whether it is on SQL or on Hadoop or a Spark, to bring out those analytics. So just an overview for everybody to understand that what are the technologies which are being used. Right. So this is what we understood, in our last thing, that what were our challenges, technology adoption, process innovation, compliance, and Industry 4.0 security. So these are some of the solutions what are available, you know, which will help you to undergo and start this transformation journey. It can start with some simple process automation or people automation, including your integrating your attendance to your canteen to save wastage of food, to reduce your misutilization of the resources, right? Or it can be one single card for all your purposes, or it can just start with tracking of your goods using RFID, or even tracking in real time using some of the latest technologies on Bluetooth and wireless. Or even it can start as a solar powered Wi-Fi in your campus, so that the digital and the renew, you know, the journey on the positive side is being taken care of. Or in fact, the best way is, because many of the manufacturing as per compliance have to have a lot of CCTVs and cameras. You already have so much of data. How do I bring vision AI to, to increase my security, to solve some of my real time challenges? Can be your first step. Right? And then as you move on, you know, different additions and modules can be added to take it to a smart campus. So when you look at it, you know, you have four main categories. One is your digital transformation or Industry 4.0. Second is your asset location and services, people and process automation, and then the smart campus. So just for clarity, that we have put these in different categories. And what are the solutions which will help in 4.0? What are some of the solutions which will do your asset location and tracking? Because when you know where are the assets, like people or even items, you can very well plan for disaster management, right? Then you have people and process relating to the people and making it a complete touchless campus, or making your campus a smart one, right? A smart campus can also be at the last stage, you know, can look at, you know, you have your own campus app, and anybody, you will start using your mobile campus app for all your factory needs, whether it is communication, whether it is directions to be given to what has to be done, or whether it is your official workflow related. Can leverage the mobile app to make it a completely a digital smart factory. All right. So I'll just pause for a second here for any of the questions to come in. So guys, raise your hand for any of the.
Is this industry for standards also inbuilt in the systems? Like basically like something like manufacturing a platform, industry 4 platform. Is that integration is a part of this entire system?
Yeah. So it's a great question, Raju. So there are different platforms available. Some are standards available from different companies. Ready-made platforms where you can add modules, different modules, and go on a journey. So, or second way is to build one by one a custom-built design and solve each of the problem as it comes. Okay. So, this we need to really look at that particular company process and flows, mm-hmm. and bring out an assessment report. And say that, okay, now this is what we recommend to do. This can be done through a workshop. assessment of the existing processes and what can be recommended.
Okay, so it's like you can adopt Industry 4 in a different levels for a different industries in different levels.
Yeah, right, absolutely right. Industry 4.0 is a very general term.
Okay.
It is like in that umbrella everything comes.
Okay, so is that something like companies with a low budget, like they don't want to spend more, you know? Can you bring cost effective solutions, Industry 4 solutions for those companies?
So absolutely. See what happened. I will give one case study, Raju. So what happened is that one of a steel manufacturing company,
okay,
he had a lot of stocks, and you cannot keep it inside your factory because it will take a lot of space.
Okay.
And these are all semi-finished goods.
Yeah.
Now, the biggest problem was that there has been a lot of leakage or pilferage.
Yeah.
Now, how do we avoid? So either, I mean, if I'm talking about digital transformation, we'll think that, oh, I have to put a weight sensor, or I have to do this, or I have to put a camera and see what length, how much they have taken, who has taken. That is a very, and you cannot adopt that kind of a technology to a trader or a ancillary manufacturing company.
Okay.
So what we did is that we gave them a solution that, okay, now let's not do anything. Let's use your existing camera. Just put the camera there. And we will build a small algorithm and on analytics saying that if anybody crosses some of these lines, and automatically you can send an alert notification to the security, and he may be doing some other work and he can come and attend this.
Okay.
So there is no much of a cost involvement. But okay, you have taken the digital transformation journey.
Okay. So it's like a modular type so that people can adopt in a modular like you can bring the modules and you can over a period of time you can implement, or one shot you need to implement.
So usually it happens always by modules. Nobody will go with one shot, right? Okay. Even companies like ABB, when we did almost like 1.5 year project for them,
okay,
even companies at such a scale, when they have money, budget and everything, or even ITC, nobody will do transformation because they will carry on their existing things, what is happening, and go one by one. So it will be a long-term, consistent and modular-wise engagement.
So for a given case, like Indian scenario for SME, small and medium enterprises, suppose if it is a 100 crores company, small company, and how much time it takes to implement from the general, if you assume their competence in IT, you know, some average background. So from that level to fully digitized factory, how much time generally takes?
Okay, no, this is a very difficult question, frankly speaking, because what happens is that to build one process, you may take right from 3 to 4 weeks to 2 to 3 months,
okay,
right? And how many lines of production are there, and what are those areas where you want to do digitalization?
Okay.
It all depends, but it can start as low as within 2-3 weeks, one module can be completed depending on the type of it.
Oh, okay.
Right. For example, you want to know, you have built a product, and in that product, there are many sub-products when you have assembled it.
Okay.
Now, how do you know whether what you have assembled is the right, you have taken the right sub-products or a child product to make a parent product?
Yeah. Correct.
Now, here we can just use QR code and you can just do it in a couple of weeks. The whole process, automate this whole thing. And now anytime before it goes out from the factory, you know that this parent product has got all these child products, which are his child.
Okay.
So this is a very interesting thing. This is done many of the times, including bigger companies, what we have seen. Is that the product is right, the label is wrong.
Okay.
Right. In Japanese, they call it as poko-yoke. That means mistake proofing. So this is a common problem because it's a human error.
Okay.
now we can use small checkpoints leveraging QR code to ensure that we don't do wrong labeling.
Great.
Right, and this is also one way of, it's a digital transformation, there's no doubt. Right. So, any questions, Raju, from anybody? Anybody has raised hands?
Yeah, any questions from the audience? You can go ahead. Our senior members are there from IPQC, Mr. Pradeep Kumar and Mr. Raghavendra. Maybe they may ask questions because they are industry veterans. I request them to, you know, ask anything related to digitization because they experienced in many transformations, you know, basically digital transformations.
Right.
I'd like to ask a question.
Yeah.
Mr. Deepak, I have worked in the industry for 35 years plus.
Okay, who is this, sir?
I started my career writing planning sheets on paper. And when I came to the end of my career, it was a full-fledged ERP system.
Oh, okay.
Right? Now, when we talk of this Industry 4.0 and see the advantages it's going to have in future and ease of work for everybody, we are struggling to see that the mindset of the industry to some level of excellence only is not there. So how does this team of Industry 4.0 plan to bring that thinking into these people? Excellence only they don't want. And digitizing everything will not give any benefit to them unless otherwise it's economical for them. I was told that the government of India has got in touch with the Bombay IIT, Delhi IIT, and some industries in institutes in Pune to develop a program for Industry 4.0 for India, similar to what they did for Z program. Because majority of the MSMEs are below 100 crores. And they're all suppliers for big companies. Except big companies like TVS, Hero Honda, or Mahindra's, all these big people who can afford to do all this, and probably their own as vendors. How do other people get into all this and understand the advantages and all that? How do we propose to do that?
Yeah, thanks, Raghavendra, for bringing this up. This is a great question. So, in fact, this is what I was saying earlier also, that we have a mindset issue. And what will eventually happen is that the bigger companies will eat up small companies, for sure. Because the benefits of 4.0 is a direct impact on your cost and revenue. And your competitor has come and made this possible and reduced his cost of production. Then what relevance you will have in the market and how long it will be, how long you will be able to sustain, that will become a biggest problem.
Correct.
And how do we solve this? I think this is also an excellent question, a great question, Raghavendra. I think one is this education, and I think even Raju, what he is doing in bringing more and more people on this platform to bring awareness to SMEs and even companies. I mean, even a 100 crore company is an SME, right? And if they don't adopt in next 5-6 years, bigger companies with their reduced and centralized manufacturing across the globe and with the AI-driven approaches will bring the cost so low that you anyway become irrelevant.
So it's a competition.
That's where, Raghavendra, I see is that we should talk and encourage people to start adopting digitalization in a small way, one by one. Because what I have seen is that even like printing company, because I had been to one printing company, they have so many huge machines and they are coming out with a new factory. Now, they don't know how to start, where to start, whom to approach and what to put. How to even first of all know that what problems can be solved using AI. He is one of the biggest gap in the market. Right. So one is that education, sir. I think education and talking to more people and giving workshops on how this can help. We will only help our own relatives in this industry to stay relevant.
Sir, any questions, sir, from Pradeep, sir?
Yeah. Good afternoon. This is Pradeep Kumar speaking. It's a very good talk, Deepak. You have covered a lot of areas. I would like to know, in terms of, say, a small camera, even if whatever you have said about the case study of that steel iron parts manufacturer. So a camera and an AI app. Okay. So how much, what will be the lowest cost that you can start it?
For example, let me give this case study. So they have already a camera, you did not invest.
Okay.
Cameras come from 4,000 to 8,000 or 10,000 maximum.
Okay.
Then you already have, when you have a camera, you have already have the network. You have stored the data in a videos in a particular storage.
Yes.
Now, what we are bringing, we are just adding an application layer on top of this hardware. It can start from 20,000 to 40,000.
Very good. Very nice. Okay.
And you can see, what I'm saying is that if you look at the whole production line, you may spend about 80,000 to 1 lakh per line to automate. Roughly. Okay. I'm just giving only the hardware part. Right. Then, because you need different hardware to do this.
Okay.
Then you need a software to run this engine and put the AI algorithm, inference node, and there are many other things. But what you are saying and what you said rightly is that what are the real pain points right now? Real pain point is not to automate my whole production line right now.
Yeah.
My real pain point is to see that, okay, one machine. Can I do monitoring from a central side to avoid theft?
Yes.
Other is the theft of the raw materials or asset tagging using RFID.
Okay.
That will reduce your expenses.
Basically, it's like a bottleneck, identifying the bottleneck and prioritizing the investment and automation or basically digitization.
Yeah, yes, Raju. And Pradeep sir has actually a relevant question. So, and cost is the biggest thing for us.
Yes.
It is like our small entrepreneurs, what we are having. You know, we cannot grow because we don't have money, muscle power.
Okay.
And even though you have everything, you can't grow. So it is like a chicken egg situation. Same thing with the customer.
No, we can start. We can start with, some either low-hanging fruits or some, we can make a Pareto where to start. For example, a quality control inspection, an inspection job to be done. Okay. We can train we can provide the data to train, and then you can have the algorithm set, okay, or pattern recognition or anything like that. Okay. So the whole process is about not just hardware, but you need to have the data and then all the AI engine to be put up. So this particular thing would cost approximately how much and how many months would it take to develop?
What happens is that, as I said, you have, suppose in one line, if you go, you need, first you have to have a display or then you have to have a QR code generator system.
Okay.
You need to have some push button then what I call as So whether, and then you have a display in the existing machine, or is it a PLC machine?
Yes.
Right. And then you need a edge computing, the local edge analytics. Right. And then you have a label printer at the end. Right. There will be set of hardware. Depending on that production line, which may cost in between 60,000 to 80,000 on the hardware, somewhere in that range, right? Then, like this, you may have multiple production lines.
Okay.
And but what happens is that only for one line, and if you want to build a software, which may cost 8 to 10 lakhs.
That is what I was looking for.
It becomes unfeasible to move it only automation only one line. But if I have 7 lines, 10 lines, then what happens is that because the software, what you do is a one-time activity to build this up.
Can I suggest one thing? Do you have any ready-made, you know, some sort of a like in robotics, when they started with the open-ended, then they said simple pick and place. Okay, there is just pick and place, something like that. Then we have that Poka-Yoke. Poka-Yoke means that there is a sensor that will say yes, no, yes, no, yes. Okay, so can you extend it into an AI an app where a complex pattern is seen, it is okay or not okay? Do you have any standardized modules like that? Face recognition is one. Face recognition is something like where you can say that, okay, that is almost a standardized app, I can say. Something like that, do you have anything in manufacturing?
There are, like Poka-Yoke is one. And then as I said, your product and child products inside the main product, QR code.
Yeah,
is the ready thing, right? Then asset management using QR, because this is already, we did it for ABB. So there are things that these are like small models which can go. Building an entire digital transformation for the entire production line is what I was talking about, a bigger picture.
Yes, that is good for big companies.
For companies like this, as I said, even you were solving your issues on theft of the raw material using a camera and just an algorithm. We have to begin from those, and that is where industry should look at and say that, okay, now this is where I am open to new technology. And that is what Raghavendra was saying, that the biggest problem is that, first of all, they don't believe that they have a problem.
Yes.
And when you don't believe that you have a problem, then whatever solution you give is of no use.
Correct.
Because it is there in our genes that 100 years my grandfather was doing, and I am doing digital process. I know manufacturing better than you. And you being an IT guy, how can you talk about to me on manufacturing? Because I have been doing this for all my years.
You're right.
But ultimately, it is like, who are the sufferers? Of course, we will have, we'll not have orders. But the end sufferer is that our company, because they will not survive. I'm very sure.
You're right.
So what is it? But I think what Mr. Pradeep is basically trying to simplify, basically the standardizing, industry for adoption. If we can standardize to some of the processes like a toolkit type, ready-made, standard module you can adopt with the hardware and software. So that type of thing, if we can bring, many small companies can adopt, that basically on the basis of their budget limitation, they can adopt those modules instead of totally one time investment, big investment, They can go for a module wise, small automation in the factory, but progressively they can reach Industry 4 after some time. So is that the type of standard approach or tools or modules is readily available in the market?
We have built it. So these are not something which are available, but we have built for customers which can be adopted to other customers.
Yeah, there are two categories of manufacturing. One is process industry, one is a discrete manufacturing. Discrete manufacturing means like anything like FMCG, automobile, all these things comes under discrete manufacturing. Process industry, these broad categories, if we can bring some low-cost automation tools, ready-made low-cost options for the industry, people take very, you know, definitely they start reaping the benefit. They start seeing the benefits.
Yeah, so we will look at it. I think even the industry people also who are there can comment. But we have these kind of things which can be taken up. No problem. That is
true. See, one of the problems that I see is in presses, high-speed presses, stamping presses, etc. Burr will be developing. What is the burr? Edge burr will be developing. Okay. It is tolerable up to some point. Beyond that, the components get rejected. Therefore, they must stop production. Okay. So this can be seen either by physical checking or by visual. Okay. So if it is visual, then it can be faster. You can check for the any ridges that are coming up. And then if you find that, then you can give a signal saying that, okay, now there is this edge is not okay. Now you need to stop the press. Okay. Am I clear? So
I got your point. So what happens here is that for one of the case study, we have to build a product which will do edge analysis. See, what is this? This is a vision AI. That means that you take the image, do the image classification, and compare it in a pixels, whatever is that algorithm, what we use at the background.
Yes.
To ensure what is right, what is wrong, and are we going towards defective?
Please. Yes.
Now, once there is a case study of a customer or a particular one machine, they should allow us to do this R&D because ultimately you are the domain people. Once that is done, then only we will come to know, okay, now what kind of a minimal hardware is required to do this image processing. Whether just a Raspberry Pi will do or whether I should use a processor at the edge to do this.
Okay.
Right? And what should be the network connectivity, whether the communication, whatever images I'm getting, is that bandwidth good enough to take that image? Or do I need a very high quality image to do this? And what kind of a camera? Is a 4,000 camera good enough? Or I need to have a 15,000 camera?
Okay.
So once we have more details on a particular problem statement,
yes,
we can suggest that what will be the economics of it.
Fair enough. Now we are coming closer to things. So you are saying that there can be a camera options, there can be a bandwidth options, there can be image processing options, etc. Okay. So this becomes one small module with certain options, right? Right?
Right.
Yeah. So with options, okay, what will be the cost range? We can work on applications like this with our clients, okay? And then say that there are many places where we can, if we can modularize certain things, these can be, as a standalone also, this can be sold.
Yeah, very much possible. So we need to see the cost, as I said, will depend on the detailing of that problem statement.
Yeah. So
it is have a camera, because for example, if the resolution required And for that, your camera itself is a minimum $50,000 or $30,000, right?
Okay.
Then the whole economics may not fly. But if we know this, okay, now this image, what I get, I can use it with a 2000 camera.
Yes.
Or
yes.
I can use it with a Raspberry Pi or NVIDIA Jetson, which is some 10-12,000 rupees hardware.
Okay.
And then add some more one-time software cost and, you know, divide it among different machines wherever we get. Then you can bring out the commercial.
Say if it is around 50,000 rupees, this may be suitable for an MSME guy, because he might be losing some 10-20 lakhs worth of in terms of rejections. Okay, rejections could be 2 or 3 lakhs or even 5 lakhs. So 50,000 rupees investment, he may be willing to make an investment.
No, so there's other way of looking at it. If you know, if there is a customer whom we are really saving, he can pay on how much ever he has saved.
So that's a model. I mean, business model.
Yeah. Happens is that what I'm saying is that we need to have more details of the problem statement and the exact data so that we can arrive at the hardware. See, ultimately, it is the hardware which will increase the cost. Because software is a one-time activity and it can be moved to multiple hardware.
Okay.
Right. Whether you need a high resolution camera, whether you need a server with so much GPUs and all, then the cost will become so much high.
Yeah. Would it be, can you visualize under 1 lakh rupee AI application? Like, see, I'm talking about a simple Poka-Yoke system. Poka-Yoke as a concept, it is well accepted in the industry. Now we are saying that it is AI enabled Poka-Yoke. Okay.
Yeah, correct.
And standalone. It can be on its own. It can be operating and it can be on one machine independently in a small manufacturer. Okay. And you can work with some, say, rough resolution camera, whatever it is. So just visualize a simple modular low cost application.
Yeah. So I can give you the details what we did. I think we can discuss on that, and that is very much possible. Those ready modules are there. One for this Poka-Yoke, and even for central monitoring. Even if there are multiple production machines and you want to manage centrally. So the costs are available, only we need to have the right case studies and problem statements.
Yeah, case studies you'll find, there's no problem. Your abilities are there, then once we walk into a shop floor, we can talk to the manufacturer and say that, okay, where he's losing maximum money in terms of whatever the quality rejections or production problems or whatever it is. And one single application we can sell. Okay.
Yeah, prototype can be made. Prototype, you can develop and you can give. So is it possible? I think it's possible. Once you give the details, probably you can give some estimation and then probably you can create some prototype and deploy it and see the benefits, and you can see that whether it's feasible or not feasible, you can do it.
Yeah.
And there is one more question, Mr. Ramesh Babu. Please go ahead and ask.
Yeah, good evening. Can you hear me?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you very much. And this time I have some small question. Like we have several software tools as well as the hardware tools to develop IoT solutions. But is there any proven procedures? Because I saw many companies, my friends and others, they are doing it on their own trial and error way. The different hardware and software, they'll be using it to find the solutions. But unlike traditional manufacturing methods, which is already proven and well written in the books. Similarly, for IoT, for any startup companies or other academicians, as well as small scale industries, is there any ways or methods that we can try before implementing IoT solutions?
Okay. So thank you, Ramesh. Appreciate and a great question here. So what we have are the guidelines and the frameworks in IoT and AI, because most of them are very custom specific to a machine, not only just about industry or that particular production. Because if you have a PLC machine, if there is no PLC, it is just no digital at all, then the data collection, acquisition from this will be a different effort and estimate for even for these two cases. So there are frameworks and guidelines which we build, but some companies like Siemens is saying that, okay, I am coming out with engineering and analytics, one platform, you take anything and all, but the platform also will have to be a huge cost, which will, so those are the challenges which are there. But in a simple answer, there are guidelines and tools and framework which we adopt to build a custom specific solution, but it is no one size fits all. It is always, always 60 to 70% customization to solve any of the manufacturing problems.
Yeah, nice. And I have one more. Pradeep was discussing about the bird detection using camera and artificial intelligence systems. In fact, now I am trying here, I'm a professor. Yes, we are trying with a simple mobile camera. Mobile cameras with Wi-Fi enabled will be using as a camera to detect the object or not to identify certain features like a birds or dimensions or shapes. But just we are at initial stage and we are trying it. What is your comment? Is it good enough for us? Because we are not using any money, just only mobile camera, and Python code is very freely available. So almost investment is zero, trying to develop an applications. Do you comment on it?
Yeah, so no, it's a good method to start, but the biggest problem is that as the data grows, your architecture at the backend software should be scalable in nature, because as a project, you can do it. And even in college projects or any of the GitHub applications, get many of them free, very much available to just showcase for a single piece. But when the scale comes or when the granularity comes and say that, oh, I am classifying the image. See, that is where once you have a training and once you have an inference in AI, right? And if you are just classifying and use a standard available algorithms freely available, they will have very general element classifications. But once you get deeper into and start working on this, you will realize that, oh, this is not sufficient. I need to really build a custom one of my own. Otherwise, it would have become a product and gone into every problem statement where you are facing a problem. But that is still not so.
Yeah, like bird detection looks to be, simple problem and easy to solve.
Yeah. So, that's what I'm saying. Once the scalability happens, you have more and what speed it is coming. So there are many other, but it's the right direction. See, there are two ways of doing it. Either you reinvent the wheel and learn something which may not be your core thing to learn, or do it, use experts who have done, and so that you don't waste your time and effort. Those are the two ways. But the direction is right.
Okay,
so the choice is whether you use people who have already done so that you become more wise by learning their mistakes, or do a self-study and self-experience and then realize that, oh, okay, let me do this way. So the choice is yours.
Thank you. Thank you.
Right. So let me go to the next. So this is what I was talking about. You know, in the production environment, if you want to do device monitoring, and you know, you will use different this edge gateway, edge node, or the IoT gateway will become different for different types of machines. So that is where the problem comes. So for a generator, you have your energy meter, you have your sensors, and these will come and, you know, get connected to your IoT gateway. And then it can go to cloud or in your own private cloud. And then you can remotely see what is happening, whether it is through mobile app or, you know, through web application. The challenge will always be that what kind of an edge node you will build to sustain that workload that comes from this particular machine. Right? So from a quality control, I think this is what we were also talking about, how we can leverage QR code for the OKIOK. And then even for quality of liquids, you know, whether it is in the right quantity and how do we measure using sensors, or quality control using vision AI is also, so there are different ways of putting things, you know, based on the exact need of the customer.
There is a great opportunity in using camera-related IoT solutions, you know, using a well-established quality systems. So designing a solutions as per the quality systems using sophisticated cameras and AI integrated AI tools. There are many you know, innovative products can be built.
Yeah, Raju, so the biggest hindrance and all this is all in the cost, and what kind of, see, whether which camera, that becomes the biggest problem. Whether 2 megapixel is good enough, whether you need an optical zoom of what nature, whether you need a proper lighting that when you capture the image, do you need a background there? So there are many, many things. Whether a vision AI can be good for quality measurement, whether a laser can be good, or whether a different sensor is good.
Yeah.
So it is, we cannot generalize, nor we can conclude.
Okay, please go ahead.
Right. Then you have different, real-time location systems from, using your Wi-Fi. So these are some of the companies where if they have Wi-Fi, and if we use, Bluetooth module to do asset tracking, real-time location system. One of the technologies which is there, which will help in the asset management. So we don't build an asset management software because that's a part of an ERP software. We are only into building that intelligence on the asset, whether it is tracking them or whether you are monitoring and you want to bring services out of it. Right? So this is how it can work on the real-time location system.
Okay.
All right. So you can. So these are some factories where they really have a Wi-Fi and they have a Bluetooth module and all. But for small companies where there is no such an infrastructure, kind of an RFID tagged products can be a good solution. Where you have RFID tags.
It is like inbound logistics and all. You can plan. You can optimize. Inbound logistics means like internal movement of the product, like internal logistics.
Yeah. So internal also, if there is Wi-Fi and if you want to really track the real location, real time, then you need to look at the BLE tags. Otherwise, an RFID tag with a long range RFID reader can be a good thing for the...
Okay, please go ahead.
Right. And you can also use QR code for your asset tracking and counting. I think this is something which a modern warehouse are really looking at it because you can use drone with the QR code cameras and then it can just give that. You need not carry a big RFID reader.
Okay.
Right. And this is something of large warehouses are really looking at different options, whether it is QR or RFID or whether it is Bluetooth.
Okay.
Right. And then I have something on why automation. This is more of a process automation on whether it is simplifying your onboarding process of an employee or a visitor or your canteen. These are custom-built automation processes can be leveraged.
Okay.
Right. Or whether it can be also for your disaster management. So if you know where are the people, a small mobile app will also, for an admin, will know that how many are in safe zone, danger zone, which location. So these are something which are there to improve your processes. For example, a visitor management. One of the customers for Triveni Turbines, we did a video testimony software. So because they had a lot of international clients, so every time they had to call photographers and videographers to take a customer testimonial. So we built an Android app and then we put it in their video testimony room. So customers will come and it will automatically, you can do your own video testimony.
Okay, wow.
Those are some of the things where they can automate their processes.
Okay.
Right. Then you'll have what can be a smart campus. Like, for example, Vision AI. Raju, you were saying that, okay, what we can do. They might have existing CCTVs. Now the same cameras can be used to do the perimeter security. If somebody is coming in the night and it can bring in alarm, and then why do you really need to put guards in all the places?
Stock cats and all they can.
You can recognize. That is what an AI algorithm will do. That whether it is a cat or a human being or whether it is a dog, you will not get false alarm. Right? It can also do counting how many people are in which place. So these are some things which you can leverage your existing infrastructure. Or some of the companies say, I want to have a custom-built mobile app for my service. Now, these are some of the things that can be done. Right. So, maybe are we with the time, how it is, Raju, are we continuing? I have a couple of more, just a smart factory, what was done. But... depending on
everybody's time, we are having 5 minutes. Probably you can take question answers. And there is one question from Mr. Raghavendra regarding the systems are now being being marketed for apartment security. Is this system, whatever you earlier shown camera related security, is that can be used for apartment security?
Yeah, they are already doing now.
Okay.
Yeah. So you will have algorithms. See, I'm just giving you, I'm not saying what all we do, whether there are competitors everywhere. There are people who are deploying many things in many ways. So technology is available.
Okay.
Only is what suits, what is better, which is better, what is cost. Are the answers you have to find.
Okay, sir.
So, Rajiv, there are no questions. Some questions that are there.
Yeah, is there any more slides?
Not much. So there were more on that smart factory, what was being done, but it will take longer time to discuss on that. It is it will take time.
Do you any plan for the workshop, something like really cases you can discuss so that people can understand how it is implemented? Now they got an overview basically through this presentation.
Next step is that we really look at some of the real-time customer places where we can solve real problems.
Okay.
And propose that this can solve this problem and this is what it is, so that it becomes useful for them.
Yeah, so that becomes a standard, you know, basically that becomes a standard solution for that specific problem.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So is that anything you are planning to do next round so that for those audience who are really interested to take this forward, you know, basically some of the projects you want to share?
So what we can do is that we now, when we know that these are some of the challenges that can be solved using technology, we can identify and look at customers, even now is there, that if they have something, we can make a half day or a one day workshop and do the assessment of what they have and give out recommendation to them that, okay, now this you can solve using this and this will help. And finally, it is their choice.
Do you have any digital transformation index or something? You can measure overall index for a factory?
Supply chain.
No, it was. There is no something like that. We have to see. One is that we have to look at what they have currently.
Okay.
So we need to understand whether what is that, either their problem statement. And we can go one by one. You cannot have an assessment of the whole factory. It is such a huge thing.
Okay.
And each one is a separate process. You may know more, even Raghavendra and Pradeep.
Yeah, there are many.
So it is such a big thing. So we have to solve using their pain points. And one is that to bring awareness, as Raghavendra was asking, what we should do, we should go to each customer and say that who is open to listen, understand their pain points, and then propose, okay, now this is what it is. Can you, if it is affordable, why don't you look, or what, that can be the next level of engagement.
So if anybody interested to assess their readiness, probably IPQC and our Mr. Deepak Guru team can help to assess the factory, like assessment where they stand, probably in the journey towards complete industry for adoption. So we can assess and we can give you some of the indicators so that they can parallelly they can implement some of the lean initiatives, some of the IoT initiatives, from some of the industry 4 initiatives. Probably we can work together and we can integrated solution we can propose. Okay. So any other questions from the audience? So we are in the last 2-3 minutes. Is there time? If anybody wants to ask a question, please let me know. We can allow you.
I would like to ask a question.
Please go ahead, sir. Go ahead and ask.
Deepak, we have been seeing about this industry 4.0 for the last almost 7 years now.
Ah, Yes, sir.
Renault and Bosch in Germany are almost in the final stages of their fine-tuning their Industry 4.0 implementation there. But as far as our country is concerned, what is the readiness that you expect from the results? We are aware. It will give better productivity, quality, all that we are aware now. But what is the readiness that they have to have? For example, in one of my earlier companies where I was working, we introduced flexible manufacturing for one line. It's an aerospace company. For one production line of Airbus, we set up flexible manufacturing, which is a fully automatic line. Loading, loading, change of tools, everything is automatic. It took around 1 to 1.5 crores of expenditure. It's about 6 years back. But the problem was the machines were not up to the level to operate that system. Frequent breakdowns in the machine, so you require the authorized person only to come and repair, like that, all those problems came. If we say we have to implement in one particular industry, what should the industry owner be ready with? If the equipments are not up to date and his people are not up to date, how can this be implemented?
Yeah, so excellent question, Raghavendra. See, what happens is that here from this point of view, see, one is that they would have already invested on their manufacturing machines and lines and their other processes they are already doing. Now, to bring out digital transformation or AI-driven approach, one is that they should not compromise on the hardware we suggest from a compute perspective. This is the biggest problem. The problem here is that they want to do everything cheap. For example, I say, okay, now for doing this quality process or getting this image, we need this compute power and we should have this particular hardware to do the analytics, to do the compute, to do the inference. I have seen is that, okay, now this is the same, okay, I need so much hardware and all, I will buy a most cheap machine which is available, rather than looking more deeper into the hardware, because the problem always comes with the hardware. It's not a software problem. The challenges are solved through software, but the problems continue with the hardware. And this is where they should not compromise. Whatever be the current machine, doesn't matter, because anyway we are putting an IoT device to ensure that we do the data. Once that happens, the most of the companies are always looking at, oh, why don't I buy some local motherboard? Why I cannot put a Raspberry Pi? Why I cannot just my Windows system to do this? And they compromise. And again, after 4 or 5 months, again, the same problem will happen. This is where what I have seen. You know, whether it is a display monitor, whether it is a touch screen, I think the quality of the hardware is they are not bothering right now.
Okay, so I think we are able to complete an answer. We answered all the questions. And any other thing, you can write to us info@ipqc.in. And if you want any information, please visit our website www.ipqc.in for any inquiries. And if you want any further help from Mr. Deepak, we can also coordinate that. I request Mr. Deepak to probably schedule one more program workshop type, so that something like more on hands-on experience, like and how actually product can be developed, IoT product for a specific industry for environment. So probably you can plan that, we can help you. So please let us know so that we can plan in advance and we can invite all the stakeholders to the event. Thank you so much for your time.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Deepak.
Okay, nice. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you.
Yeah, okay.